today. Amen. I pray that God's favor would touch you, bless you, and refresh your soul. Amen. Open your Bibles, please, to the book of Hebrews. We're in Hebrews chapter 12, and we're going to begin on the first verse. Hebrews, the 12th chapter, the first verse. Will you stand with me, saints? Today we praise the Lord. Today we exalt the King. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin, and ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. If ye endure chastising, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom his father chasteneth not? But if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For they verily for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. Now, no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down in the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. Follow peace with all men, and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Let's look at verse 12 and read it together. Hebrews 12:12. Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down, and the feeble knees. Hebrews 12:12. Let's pray. Father, I just thank you for love and fellowship and promise and grace today, Father. I thank you for truth and favor in your house, Father, in your word and in your presence. Today, Father, I ask you minister to us. Father, I ask that you would afford blessing and favor, and Father, minister through us that you might be exalted. Bless all the women of the court of this building this day, Father, that you would be exalted on high. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated, saints. Look what the Lord has done.
Well, now look what the Lord has done.
He's ever just like. presence is singing. Come to the presence of praise. Dancing hands with thankful hearts. We are going to celebrate. All of heaven's waiting. How is the Lord of praise? So we shout hallelujah. Lift it to you. Not your way. You deserve the highest praise. We give you Lord. Lord, we give you our praise. That's what we came here for. You deserve the highest praise. We give you Lord. Lord, we give you our praise. Come into your presence of singing. Come into your presence of praise. Into your gates with thankful hearts. We are going to celebrate. All of heaven's waiting. Come on the grave. So we shout hallelujah. Lift it to you. Remind you all of praise. You deserve the highest praise.
Thank you. I worship you.
That is Church, if you will just stand and continue to praise him.
She's done my heart, all of my things. To the altar, the Father's arms.
Let's bless the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, thanks. Bless somebody. Welcome them. Shake their hand. Extend love and favor in the grace of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Bless us. Hallelujah. Bless you, brother. Great to have you here. Hallelujah. Everybody, love on somebody and grow in the Lord. You know, we'll get to heaven. We're going to spend a little bit of time doing that. Amen. Greeting one another, blessing one another, praising the Lord together. Amen. Sharing all the good things God's doing, what He's done, what He's about to do, His favor, His grace, His answers to prayer, His miracles. Amen. He is a mighty, big God. And He loves us a lot. Amen. We're going to go to the throne of grace this morning. One of our brethren is in the hospital, Brother Paul Gleason. And he needs healing in his heart, his arteries. Each day we get a report, and God is doing more and more. But the Bible says where two or three agree upon a thing, it shall be done. Amen. We want him well. We want him home. We want his family refreshed and encouraged in the Lord. So let's pray. Amen. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I thank you that you love us. Father, that you answer prayer. Father, that you hear us. And Father, that you move. Right now, Father, I bring Paul Gleason before you, Father. I ask you to minister healing to his heart, his circulatory system, Father, his arteries, his respiratory system, Father, his lungs. Father, increasing strength and favor and healing touch, that you might be exalted, Father, as you guide the doctors and nurses, Father. Each thing that they are doing, that it would be beneficial, Father, and they would see what you are doing, Father, and give you praise. Father, touch and comfort his wife, his daughter's father. Show them how mighty you are. And Father, raise him up to testify of your glory. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 So remember him in your prayers this week. And thank the Lord. Every time you think of it, say, thank you, Lord, for healing Paul Gleason. Amen. Yeah. See, the thing about prayer is once you ask, you shift over into thanks. Mm-hmm. And that transforms the way you pray. Mm-hmm. Amen. It's good to thank God. You say, I haven't seen it yet. Thank God you will see it. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Let's cover this week's blessings. The mission of Bethel Chapel: to reach, teach, build, equip, and send. The vision of Bethel Chapel: to reach the lost for the cross. Our theme for the year: hope from above. Our verse for January: Luke 21:28. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. Brand new verse for the month of April, Colossians 3:2. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. Colossians 3:2. That ties right in with last week's verse, which was Colossians 3:1. Of course, you all knew that, right? Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That's why we hide them inside. No growth groups this Wednesday, but a week from this Wednesday, we start up our growth groups. Let me say that again. No growth groups this Wednesday, but we'll start up our growth groups again next Wednesday. Amen? We're going to start next week is Resurrection Sunday. We'll start the Wednesday following. We're going to show a couple of videos for that in just a minute. But first, our prayer family, the Fleming family, we're praying for Tanya. We're praying for Leon. We're praying for DeAndre. Asking God to touch and bless them. Amen? So let's do our connection blessing. Today we're giving away a gift card to Regal Cinema. And we're doing this because this week until Thursday, they're showing the film His Only Son. Brand new release, and it's about the story of Abraham and Isaac. Really powerful. They said depending on the attendance, they may or may not show it a second week, but they're definitely showing it this week. So, if you have an opportunity, you might want to see it. It's real. I've seen the trailer.
Powerful, powerful. Amen. Thank you. Oh, let's sing a song.
Well, I'm wrapped up, I'm tied up, I'm tangled up in Jesus. I'm wrapped up, I'm tied up, I'm tangled up in Jesus. I'm wrapped up, I'm tied up, I'm tangled up in Jesus. I'm wrapped up, tied up, tangled up in love.
Thank you, brother. Sister Susan Kigan. Woo-hoo! Bless you. Yes, Dad, show you what to do with that. Amen. Good to have helpers. Amen. Train while they're young, and when they are old, they will not depart from it. Amen. Let's worship God with our tithe and offering. Let's get back into the Lord as He has blessed.
You can't outgive the Lord, no matter what you do, for you'll find out in the end that the Lord's outgiven you. Your silver and your gold, your love and service too. Yes, you'll find out in the end that the Lord's outgiven you. Oh, you can't outgive the Lord, no matter what you do. For you'll find out in the end that the Lord's outgiven you. Your silver and your gold, your love and service too. Yes, you'll find out in the end that the Lord's outgiven you.
Amen. Prayer with the gifts of the givers, those that have not to give. Remember the Fleming family as you pray today.
The Christian Heavenly Father, Lord, I just want to thank you for everything that you're doing in our
lives. Yes, Lord.
Lord, I ask your healing touch on the Fleming family. I ask that everyone that has given and those that have not to give, Lord, I ask that you bless us abundantly. And thank you for everything that you're doing in our lives, Lord. Thank you for bringing us here. Lord, I also want to pray over the pastor from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. Bless him and let us receive all the words and all the blessings in your Son, name Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's show those video clips. We've got one for the Wednesday night series. We're going to be in Psalm 23, and then we'll show the one for the men's series. Genesis, right? Genesis. Okay. Did I load them? Oh, good.
Succeeded in ways unimaginable to most of us, but he also endured horrific heartbreak. Out of the heart of David comes this phrase, "The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want." What we have in this passage is a picture of the Christian life. The rest that you so desperately long for will not be found in vacation. It will not be found in a new Netflix series. True rest, rest for the soul, is found as we listen to the Good Shepherd and he leads us to green pastures and living waters. I am not a stranger to loss. I am not a stranger to hurt. I'm not a stranger to having a doctor sit across from me and tell me I'll be dead in a couple of years. And so the promise we get here is not a life without pain. It's that he is with you in this valley. It doesn't take God's people long to forget about God and choose our own path, our own way. The good news of Psalm 23 is that when we surrender our life to Christ, when we say yes, we become believers. We have been given the righteousness of Christ. We've been placed on the path of righteousness. What God's bringing is not misery, it's not begrudging submission, it's goodness. If God's big plan for your life is goodness, there are few things that fire up the heart of King David, like the idea of being in the presence of God, our Creator. We were created for that. There's goodness and mercy for the sinner, the struggler, the weary, and we're invited into the presence of God.
That'll be a week from this Wednesday. You can go and click the next one. This is the men's lesson.
Dad, that's a baby. in the beginning God. If you can believe these four words in Genesis, you can believe the rest of the Bible, and you can enjoy our trek through the study of Genesis. I want you to listen to the very first subject introduced in all of the Bible. He is the first subject in the very first sentence of the very first chapter of the very first book. It's almost a clue as to how all of life begins. In the beginning, God. That's right. Genesis is a hymn book. An H-I-M book. No other subject, person, thing, or picture dominates the landscape of life from a biblical perspective other than Him, other than God.
Amen. Well, that'd be the men's study a week from this Wednesday. You ever forget what's going on? You know, you just open up your app and you click on the calendar. And all the stuff is right there. Amen. It's good to know what's going on. Amen?
Amen.
If it's not on there, you call here at the church. You press 4, which is my extension. And then on there, I tell you what's going on for that day. I don't tell you the whole week because the recording would take forever. But I tell you what's going on that day. Amen. So that's a good way to find out if you forget. Everybody knows the church phone number, right?
Mm-hmm.
If you don't, it's on everything that you need. Amen. Let's dismiss the children and their workers. Do you know that it's Palm Sunday? We're going to praise the Lord today. Amen. Wow. I got so much to share and so little time to share it in. So, let's see how we do. Would you open your Bible, saints, to Matthew 21? Do you know what I love about the Word of God? It's God's love letter to us. Of truth and promise and blessing and breakthrough and favor and answer and miracle and healing and grace. Everything we need is covered in this book. And how to access it. But most importantly, how to get to heaven. Matthew chapter 21, verse 1. And when they drew nigh into Jerusalem and were come to Bethphage under the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus 2 disciples, saying unto them, go into the village over against you, and straightway ye shall find an ass tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them unto me. And if any man say aught unto thee, ye shall say, the Lord hath need of them, and straightway he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell ye the daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek, and sitting upon an ass, and a colt, the foal of an ass. And the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them, and brought the ass and the colt, and put on them their clothes, and they set him thereon. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strawed them in the way. And the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest! And when he was coming to Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? And the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee. And Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out all them that sold and bought in the temple and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves and said unto them, it is written, my house shall be called the house of prayer, but ye have made it a den of thieves. And the blind and the lame came to him in the temple and he healed them. And when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were sore displeased and said unto him, hearest thou what these say? And Jesus saith unto them, yea, have ye never read out of the mouth of babes and sucklings, thou hast perfected praise? And he left them and went out of the city into Bethany, and he lodged there. Isaiah 50, verse 7. Isaiah 50, verse 7, our key verse. We'll have it on the screen for you. Isaiah 50, verse 7. For the Lord God will help me. Therefore shall I not be confounded. Therefore have I set my face like a flint. And I know that I shall not be ashamed. Isaiah 50, verse 7.
Amen.
Deacon Robertson, would you pray for the message and messenger today?
Yes, sir. No, we thank you.
Amen. You may be seated, saints. If you need a miracle, today's a good day to get it.
Amen.
If you need an answer to prayer, today is a good day to get it. If you need a breakthrough in your life, today is a good day to get it. If you need healing in your finances, in your way of thinking, in the things that you don't understand, today is a good day to get it. You know how the getting is in God's kingdom? It starts with the asking. You know how the asking starts? It starts with the repenting. You know how the repenting starts? With the humbling. Are you catching on?
Yeah.
It's all about us doing what we would not expect to receive from God, the very thing that we need most. Mm. So you humble yourself, you repent before Him, you ask, and then God lovingly moves on your behalf. And it doesn't happen any other way. So many times we miss what God has for us because we don't take time to humble ourselves and repent and then ask Him. Maybe we should take some time. Amen.
Amen.
Maybe no matter what's going on today, maybe no matter what's going on this week, maybe you should take some time and get along with God.
Amen.
You know, it can be difficult at times to keep your eyes focused on Jesus. We live in a world with so many distractions, so many things that pull at us and tug at us and try to keep us to doing whatever. And we need to look at the Savior. We need to see what He's doing and where He's going and what He's asking and what He wants of us. We cannot allow ourselves to become weary of following and obeying the Lord. Galatians 6:9, let us not be weary in well-doing. Oh! And let us not be weary in well-doing. When you're doing good, don't get worn out from it.
Amen.
Don't get tired of doing good things.
All right.
Don't do so many good things that you give up on doing good things. Can I say that loud enough? Let us not be weary in well-doing. For in due season we shall reap if we faint not.
Amen.
What's due season? The time God appoints.
Amen.
You plant a seed in the ground, it starts growing, but you can't see it.
Amen.
Some days later, some weeks later, some months later, you see a sprout. But the fruit, the harvest, is in the appointed season of God. What you're sowing today is going to reap fruit way over here. You know why we get weary in well-doing? Because we sow on Sunday and we want to know why we don't have it on Monday. Monday's blessing is from sowing way back over there.
Amen.
Sometimes months. Sometimes even years.
Amen.
Hello. So maybe the answer is that we would diligently sow every day. Plant every day. Then you have a harvest, a season every day, a blessing. Amen?
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
This is the first in the series. Sunday's coming! The message today, keep your eye on the goal. You know, Jesus kept His eye focused on doing what His Father wanted. We read His life, we read the testimony of what He did, we read how He lived and the things He said and where He went. And sometimes you're reading in the Scripture and what Jesus does or says just makes perfect sense. It's like, well, yeah, of course that would be what He would do. And then there's other times He said or did something and it doesn't make any sense at all. It's like he's not even paying attention to what's going on around him. But he always kept his eye on the goal. What was the goal? What was the goal? What was the goal?
The cross.
That's the ultimate goal. I heard a phrase this last week, and it's something that seems to be creeping up in our culture.
Right.
Happens a lot with children. Sometimes you hear it with teens and young adults, and they make this statement, well, my superpower is... You heard that phrase?
Yep.
And what they mean is, these are the things I'm really good at. All this other stuff is nothing, but my superpower is... And I thought, what was Jesus' superpower? Think about that just a second. What was Jesus' superpower?
God is.
Well, his Father. But what was the thing that Jesus was absolutely perfect at? And if you say, well, everything, that's not what I'm talking about. What was the thing that he did that allowed him to do everything else that he did? There was one thing that he did that let him do everything else.
Listen to the Father.
Right there. He obeyed his daddy. Jesus' superpower was obey the Father.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says he said and did what the Father told him to do. And because of that, he could do everything else that the Father wanted him to do. If you anchor into the truth that I am going to develop in my life the ability to listen to and obey the Father, there will be nothing that will stop you from doing what God wants you to do.
Amen. Amen.
See, he blesses us in our obedience.
Amen.
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 He doesn't bless us in our feelings. He doesn't bless us in our wants. He blesses us in our obedience.
Amen.
If you're obedient, then he takes care of your wants and your needs and everything else.
Amen.
If you're not obedient, he doesn't take care of anything. Even though he graciously still gives you air.
Ooh, thank you, Lord.
And water.
Ooh, thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
I mean, think about that, you know. I, to this day, haven't received a bill from my Father for air. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. I don't know about you, but I breathe a lot of it. Sometimes, even when I'm not thinking about it. Hello?
Hello.
I don't think about it when I go to sleep at night. But I'm obviously breathing. Amen?
Amen.
Jesus never gave up. And we, if we're going to do what he did, must never give up. Either. Isaiah 50 verse 7, for the Lord God will help me. Therefore shall I not be confounded. Therefore have I set my face like a flint, and I know that I shall not be ashamed. He set his goal to do what the Father wanted him to do. He set his face like a flint to go to the cross. So saints, stay the course, stay faithful, and God will see you through.
Amen.
Christianity is all about what is empty and what is full. This is Palm Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
He hasn't been crucified yet.
Oh, no.
He hasn't been laid in the grave yet.
Mm-hmm.
But we need to be thinking about what is empty and what is full. The tomb is empty. We live on this side of it. Amen?
Amen.
And the tomb is empty so your heart can be full. He left the tomb so he can live in you.
Amen.
He left the tomb so he could be at the right hand of the Father interceding
for
us.
Right.
Jesus is not in the tomb, therefore, he can live in your heart.
All right.
Amen?
Amen.
I might touch on that a little bit next week as well, being an empty tomb thought. Amen.
Amen.
But I want you to know that all of the Word is there to encourage you and bless you. Amen?
Amen.
Number one, prophecy is fulfilled. This is holy.
Amen.
God's Word is holy.
Amen.
Amen.
It's not a dime store novel.
No, it's not.
I do something. It's kind of weird. But I do it. Other than word, I don't put anything on the Bible. That's just something I do. I don't set a newspaper on it. I don't set a magazine on it. I don't set another book on it. Unless it's another book that's filled with the word.
Amen.
Nothing sits on my Bible.
Amen.
That's my mental way of reminding myself it gets first place. First place in my heart, first place in my thoughts. When I look at the library, I want this to be the first book that I see. I want to have to move this book to get to another book. You see where I'm going? But it's not just holy. It's anointed.
Amen.
It's prophecy.
Amen.
There's so many things in here that were prophesied that have been fulfilled, and there's quite a few in here that have been prophesied that haven't been fulfilled quite yet.
Amen.
But we'll get soon. The brethren and I were just talking this morning about some of the things that are really soon. Matthew 21:4, all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying. What's the all this was done stuff? Hey, disciples, go over there in that little town. You're going to find a colt and an ass. They're going to be all tied up. Untie them and bring them to me. And if anybody says anything to you, tell them the master has need of them. And they will let you go. So, Brotherhood, imagine for a minute that I'm walking with Jesus. And he's here today. And he says, Evans, I need you to go over there to Eagle River. And there's going to be a car on the side of the road with the keys in it. Just get in and drive it over to me. And if anybody says anything, just tell them the master needs it. And they'll let you go. Did you just get that?
Yes.
See, it's not go out into the wilderness and find some animal that's caught. It's not go over to your friend's house where the guy says, I've been waiting for you all week. I heard that Jesus was coming and he's going to need this. You're going to go into the town. You're going to find a foal and a colt tied. That means somebody owns them. And if anybody says anything to you, you're just going to say the master needs them.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
I'm coming to get your car. Not my car, the master needs it. Oh, okay. Did you get it?
Amen.
Because we don't even know if the person from whom those were being given was a follower of Jesus. The scripture doesn't tell us. I would like to think yes, but thinking doesn't mean it's so. But all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, what did the prophecy say? Your king is going to come riding on a colt.
Uh-huh.
Well, riding on an ass, a foal of a colt. Wow. Jesus sent them over there only because it said it. Remember what I said at the beginning? He did what his father said.
Mm-hmm.
That was his superpower. Oh, Dad, is it time? It's time. We get all excited. It's the triumphal entry. Oh, I can't wait. What's next? They're going to put their hands up. They're going to praise him. It's so exciting. I don't think that's what was going on in Jesus' heart. Because when his dad says, now is the time.
That's right.
I got about a week. I've been telling them, I got about a week. And they're going to crucify me. Mm-hmm. He knew, and he'd been telling them, but they didn't get it. So while everybody is rejoicing, this is going on in him. Think about that. Doesn't that change our understanding of the sacrifice he made? The Bible says he knew the scriptures about himself. I've often thought what it was like for him in his training when he was growing up in school, because in traditional Hebrew school, they start with the word, then they do their other studies. I wonder what it was like when they're reading in the Psalms. And there's all these passages in Psalm 22 about Jesus.
Amen.
When they're reading in Isaiah, and all these passages are about Jesus.
Amen.
Imagine if you just study these over and over and over, and you hear them over and over. That's about me. Oh, they're going to pull my beard out. Oh, they're gonna whip me with the cat of nine tails. Would take on a whole new meaning, wouldn't it? Did you know there's over 300 prophecies concerning Jesus? Almost all of them have been fulfilled. And the few that have not are really close. It says in Luke 24:44, and he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses, and in the prophets, and in the Psalms, concerning me. Hey guys, I'm not just talking about prophecies, I'm talking specifically about prophecies about me.
All right.
And they will all be fulfilled. All prophecy will be fulfilled if it's of God, amen? But he wanted them to know it wasn't just one or two prophecies about him, it was a lot of prophecies about him.
Amen.
Having faith in God and knowing the Bible is true, and it helps us receive salvation through his Son. His Son is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
Amen.
Jesus Christ did die on the cross.
Mm-hmm.
He did shed his blood for all mankind.
Amen.
Jesus did go to hell.
Yes, he did.
Jesus did pay the price for sin.
Yes, he did. Amen.
So when someone says, well, it just won't work for me. I've done too many bad things. Jesus died for those bad things too.
All right. Amen.
Matthew 12:40. And as Jonas was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Okay, so if you're taking notes, write this down. Jesus did not die on Friday. Oh no, I heard about it. Good Friday. There was nothing good about the day he died except you get salvation. But he didn't die on Friday. How do you know? Because the scripture says the first day of the week, the ladies went to the tomb. And he was out of there. He was gone.
Amen.
Well, that's Sunday morning. We'll talk about that next week for just a minute, maybe. Yeah. The empty tomb. Still empty, brother. Oh, I'm getting into next week's message. But he came out of the grave Saturday night after 6 p.m. So anybody that can do math, I'm not really good at it, but I can do this because I can do it on one hand. Saturday at 6 p.m. minus one day would be Friday at 6 p.m. Friday at 6 p.m. minus one day would be Thursday at 6 p.m. Thursday at 6 p.m. minus one day would be Wednesday at 6 p.m. See how I did that? I took from the date and time we have given in Scripture, and I went back according to this one. It says 3 days and three nights. If you go get a hotel, and they give you 3 days and three nights on Tuesday, and they show up on Wednesday evening and say, get out, we need the room, you say, I got 3 days and three nights. They say, oh no, we counted. Tuesday night, Wednesday, goodbye. Would you go for that? How can we understand that when we're in a hotel, but we can't understand that when we read the Bible? Does that make sense? And they came and got him off the grave before 6 p.m. on Wednesday. Because the scripture says it was a high day. See, people immediately think it had to be Friday because Passover started Friday at 6 p.m. But this was a high day, it says in John. I said Passover, not Passover, Sabbath, started Friday at 6 p.m. But this was a high day, and Sabbath could happen any time in the 7 days in the week preceding. And in this case, on this week, it was Wednesday. So what did I tell you to write down? Jesus didn't die on Friday. So you can bring that up today, this week at work, with your co-workers. Because a lot of them are going to be talking about Good Fridays. They didn't die on Friday. Oh, yes, he did. Oh, no, he didn't. And take him right there to John 12:40 and let him count the days. Because if I start counting on Friday at 6 p.m. to Saturday at 6 p.m., is how many days? Three? One! The Bible is so clear, but you have to study it. Wow, look at that clock. I only got to point one. Colossians 2:13-15, and you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, have he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross.
Amen.
That was our cross.
Amen.
And Jesus made it his cross for us.
Yes,
having spoiled principalities and powers, and made a shoe of them openly, triumphing over them in it. That's when he whooped the devil. Wow. Number one, prophecy is fulfilled. Number two, Jesus is honored. It says in Matthew 21:8, and the multitude that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
Amen.
Isn't that passage dynamic?
Amen.
Here's Jesus on the colt that the disciples have taken and put their clothes on it, put Jesus on it, and they're leading it through town. And the Bible says the people in the way started taking their garments off, their outer coats off, and throwing them in the road. Do you know what that means? See, that was customary when someone of notoriety, a prominent king or someone was coming, you would take your coat off and throw it in the way. Meaning, it's not good for you to walk on the dirt, or for the animal that you're on to walk on the dirt, or for the servants that are carrying you on their shoulders to walk in the dirt. Instead, the ground must be leveled, and we will sacrifice that you might be elevated out of the dirt. We don't understand all these customs and why this was going on, but it wasn't a few of them, it was a whole bunch of them. And then they started breaking off palm branches and started waving them. That's what you did for a king.
Amen.
We exalt you. We honor you. We lift our hands. We lift our palms before the Lord. But you take the palm branches, and what you're saying is, if only I could be taller. If only I could be higher. If only I could let everybody know that I love him more than anything. And you honored him. The disciples didn't say, this is Messiah. They just put him on the colt. And the people recognized it was Messiah and started giving him praise. Let me read the verse again. And the multitude that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, blessed he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Mm.
Do you honor Jesus Christ? Will you honor Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Amen.
John 3:16-18, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God.
Amen.
When someone says to you, are you saved? Are you born again? Let me back that up. Let me rephrase that. When you say to somebody, are you saved? Are you born again? Do you know Jesus as your personal Savior? And they say, well, I'm not ready yet. That's this right here.
Amen.
He that believeth not, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already. Well, I'm not ready yet. Then you're condemned. Oh, no, I'm not going to hell. I'm a good person. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? I'm not ready yet. You're condemned.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think I like your gospel. It's not my gospel. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. His gospel. Amen. Amen. I don't think I like your religion. I don't have a religion. I have a relationship with the Father.
Amen.
I just love to flip things around and get people thinking about reality. Amen?
Amen.
The sad thing is, God doesn't want anybody condemned.
Nobody. Amen.
God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance.
Yes.
But he will allow them to walk past the cross and into the depths of hell. Because he won't make anybody who doesn't want to be in heaven go there. Isn't that just sad? But isn't that just love? Wow. How do you honor the Lord, saints? We don't have Jesus coming through town today. We don't have Jesus on a colt today. We aren't able to take our coats off and throw them in the way. We don't have palm branches to wave before him today. How do we honor the Lord?
Obedience.
Does your speech honor the Lord?
Amen.
The words come out of your mouth, do they give him praise?
Mm-hmm. All right, preacher. Make it plain.
Do your actions honor the Lord? The things you do, does it give him glory and praise? Does your church attendance honor the Lord?
All right, preacher.
Do people know that you're sold out because you're there when the doors are open? Because you want to be there, not because someone made you go there.
Amen.
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 Do you honor the Lord with your finances? Do you give your tithe, your offering, your alms?
Amen.
Does your prayer time and your Bible reading honor the Lord? Do you set a time aside every day to pray and read the Word? Do you put it before the other stuff in your life? But Pastor, I've got so many things going on today. Let me tell you, I've got lots going on every day. But I have to have time with God.
Amen.
If I don't have time with God, then I'm not in talking relationship, fellowship with him.
Right.
Communion with him. Do you honor the Lord in your thoughts and in your heart? Is he above all? I should add this. It's not on here. I have to write it in later. Do you honor the Lord by the people you bring to church with you? Not just your family. How about the neighbors, the strangers? How about the co-workers?
Amen.
Just fill up the car and bring them in. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Hey, brother. You got it easy. You got lots of seats on the rig you come to church with sometimes.
Right.
Brother Thomas. He got a big bus. Amen. Fill it up. Just bring him in. Psalm 150, verse 6. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise ye the Lord. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. I need to close. Number one, prophecy is fulfilled. Number two, honor the Lord. Number three, or Jesus is honored. Number three, the sick are healed.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to read this passage and give you a thought that will hopefully just let you see this whole thing different. Matthew 21:14. And the blind and the lame
yes.
came to him in the temple and he healed them. I told you earlier that when they put their clothes in the way and Jesus is coming into town and they said, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to the King, Hosanna to the Son of David, Hosanna in the highest. They were acknowledging him. And Jesus is thinking about Calvary.
Amen.
And he goes into the temple, the scripture says, and he overturns the tables of the money changers.
Right.
By the way, a little historical study. There's a prophecy in the Old Testament that Messiah will come through the eastern gate
yes.
of the temple. Not the eastern gate of the city, the eastern gate of the temple. The temple was sealed in Solomon's day. And it was prophesied that it wouldn't be open until Messiah came. History says that when Jesus came into Jerusalem on the colt, he went around and went through the eastern gate. Mm-hmm. And now they're all watching him. Because nobody goes through the eastern gates. Because it's sealed until Messiah comes. And he overthrows the tables. He says, my father's house is a house of prayer. You made it a den of thieves.
Yes.
And what did I tell you he's thinking? He's thinking about Calvary. He's thinking about the sacrifice. He's thinking about his death just a few days from now. And he stops everything that he's doing and he heals them. He heals the blind and the lame. He takes time out of everything he's doing to mend the broken. To restore their bodies, to refresh their minds, to heal their hearts. Wow! He could have said, Dad, isn't dying enough? And he stopped to meet the needs. How many times in Jesus' ministry did he stop? He's going to do something and he just stops. And meets the need of somebody. Has a conversation with them and loves on them. The woman who had the issue of blood. Jairus, whose daughter had fallen sick. The centurion who comes to him and says, my servant is sick in the bed. We have passage after passage after passage. We have one time when the disciples and Jesus are traveling and they come upon a funeral procession. It's customary in a funeral procession that everybody steps back. And you let the grieving procession go by and the grieving family go by and you remember them and you pray for them. Jesus didn't do it like that.
No, he didn't.
The funeral procession is coming by and Jesus just climbs on top of the casket. That's what it says he did. It says he got on top of the casket and then he did, I mean that right there was like, oh, get rid of this kooky guy. And he starts opening the lid. That's what Jesus did. And they immediately set it down because they don't know what else to do. And Jesus just reaches inside, takes the hand of the young man, and commands him to come to life. And he gets up in the casket. And the scripture says, and he presents the boy, the lad, we don't know exactly how old he was. He wouldn't have been 30 and they wouldn't have called him a lad. To his mother.
That's right. Yeah.
Alive again. And he gets off the casket and goes about his business. Jesus didn't do things like we do things.
That's right, man.
He always detoured when the Father told him to.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus is preparing to die for the sin of the world. And he stops to pray for the people who need to be healed.
Amen.
He's thinking about Calvary, and the Father's thinking about the hurting. So Jesus is thinking about the hurting. That's love. Amen?
Amen.
God has made provision in his word for you to be healed. Isaiah 53:5, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes, we are healed.
Amen.
The prophecy in Isaiah says, are. Not going to be, are. Now listen to the fulfillment of the prophecy in 1 Peter 2:24. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed.
Amen.
The prophecy says you are. The fulfillment says you were. Neither one of them say going to be. We should be walking in healing.
Amen.
We should be walking in healing. Healing the sick is important to the Father, so it was important to Jesus. So it should be important to us. People were healed in the Old Testament, they were healed in the New Testament, and people are healed today by the power of God. Today we prayed for Paul Gleason. I'm expecting to get up out of that bed. I'm expecting to be completely well, no matter what the doctors think. Because we're not healed based on what they think, we're healed based on what God said.
Amen.
And if you come up for prayer, and you need prayer or healing, and your head says, I don't know if it can happen, you just remember what God thinks about the sick. He thinks them well.
Amen.
He thinks them healed. He wants them well and healed. Amen?
Amen.
Matthew 4:23-24, and Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. That means there wasn't anybody that came to Jesus and he said, no, that was too much for me.
Mm-hmm.
No, Dad can't heal that one. Healed it all. And his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with divers diseases and torments, and those which were possessed with devils, and those which were lunatic, and those that had the palsy. And he said, sorry, I can't help those guys. No, it says, and he healed them.
Amen.
It didn't matter what they brought to Jesus. Jesus just prayed for them, and the Father did his business. God doesn't want people sick. He doesn't want their bodies tormented. He doesn't want their minds troubled. He doesn't want the devil running loose. Amen. Boy, I get excited.
Amen.
But saints, if you don't read the Bible like it's real, then what are you doing? And if it's not real to you today, what are you doing? Amen.
Amen.
Wow. You do read it like it's real. You do read it like it's for you. I wonder if we would just grab what God has for us today. Matthew 8:16, and when the evening was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils, and he cast out the spirits with his word.
That's right.
And healed all that were sick.
Amen.
When you're praying for some of the demon possessed, you better make sure you're in tune with God.
Amen.
And then when you pray for some of the demon possessed, you better speak the word. You don't lay hands on the demon possessed. You simply speak the word. Hello. Matthew 9:35. And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues. See, he went to church first. And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues. He started out in the tabernacle and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, that's salvation, through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And then it says, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. So he went to church. He preached the gospel, and then he went and healed the sick. You see the order? There's an order to things that God does.
Amen.
Wow! Wow! Oh, turn the page. Yes, Lord. Matthew 10:1. And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power. Are you a disciple of Jesus?
Yeah.
Woo! I like that! And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he called the 12 because that's all he had right then. But it grew. Another passage, just a few chapters down, he has 70. Hello? You say, no, just the 12 are mentioned. No, it says he sent forth 70. And they were his disciples.
Yes.
It was growing. It went from 12 to 70. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
The next time, it doesn't even number them. It says a great multitude of disciples followed him. Wow! Which means this covers you.
All right.
And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits.
Amen.
And to cast them out. And to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease.
That's right.
If you're a disciple of Jesus, he has given you power. To cast out devils.
All right. Amen.
Power to pray for the sick and for them to be healed.
All right. Amen.
I wonder what would happen if all the church started acting like they were disciples of Jesus. When the co-worker comes to you you with a runny nose, pray for them. You have authority over that.
Amen.
Oh, that's kookiness, preacher. Oh, nothing kooky about it when they get healed. They say, oh, well, I just got a good night's sleep. I'm better now. I had a good broth last night. No, you're healed because God healed you. The broth was just because it tasted good. Matthew 12, 9 through 15. And when he was departed thence, he went into their synagogue. He's back in the church again. And behold, there was a man which had his hand withered. And they asked him, saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath days? That they might accuse him. See, they'd already seen his pattern where he went to church and preached the gospel and healed for the sick. So here he shows up on Sabbath and they set a trap. So they think. Mm-hmm. And he said to them, he doesn't even answer their question. I love the way Jesus talks. What man shall there be among you that shall have one sheep, and if it fall into a pit on the Sabbath day, will he not lay hold on it and lift it out? See, the law said you couldn't do that. To lift out a sheep, you break a sweat. The law said you can't break a sweat on Sabbath. You have to wait till the next day. He said, but if you're out there and one of your sheep falls in the pit on the Sabbath, you don't leave it there until the next day. You reach down there and you get it. That's what he said. Which of you, if your sheep falls in the pit, will you not get it? How much then is a man better than a sheep?
Amen.
If you would reach down into a pit and get a sheep, shouldn't we reach down into the pit and get a man that's fallen into the pit?
Right.
Shouldn't we get the co-worker, the friend, the loved one that's fallen into the pit?
All right.
Who not just their body is withered, but their soul is withered?
All right.
Amen.
Amen.
How much then is a man better than a sheep? Wherefore, it is lawful. It is lawful to do well on the Sabbath days. You're not supposed to go out there and break a sweat just because you feel like it. But if someone is in a pit, it's okay to get him out.
Amen.
Even if it's Sabbath.
Amen.
Wow.
That's good.
Then saith he to the man, stretch forth thine hand. And he stretched it forth and it was restored whole like as the other. Then the Pharisees went out and held a council against him, how they might destroy him.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath day? I mean, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? He said it's lawful to do good on the Sabbath day. Amen?
Amen.
But when Jesus knew it, he withdrew himself from thence, and great multitudes followed him, and he healed them all. He went to church, they set a trap, he healed the man with the withered arm, set them straight according to the law, and the people who were sick that were going to go into the church and get healed, when Jesus left, they followed the healer.
Amen.
They didn't stick around and follow the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They followed the healer, and he healed them. Thanks, Christianity is all about what is empty and is full. It's all about whether you let Jesus into your empty heart and let him fill it up. It's all about whether you let him have his way or you just do your thing.
All right.
It's about whether you put him first or you put everything else first. Are you trying to build something for you in this earth or are you trying to build his kingdom? Are you willing to empty out your life and allow Jesus to fill it up? Matthew 16:25. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. Since the tomb is empty, so your heart can be full. Jesus paid the price for our sins so we can ask God to forgive us and so we can go to heaven. Jesus took the scourging so that we could receive the healing.
Amen.
That's right.
If you need healing and you don't get it, it's almost like saying, Jesus, you need to go get another stripe for me. Because the 490 you took wasn't enough. Hello? Why am I on this today? Because I think we've been conditioned to believe that the only way we can get healed is if we get drugs from the doctor. or if we get a prescription from the doctor, or if we do the regimen that the doctor says. I'm not saying there aren't things that the doctor can tell you that's good. But if we don't go to the healer, we're sitting around with a bunch of Pharisees and Sadducees.
That's right.
And then no wonder we're not healed. John 3:30, he must increase, but I must decrease. He must increase, but I must decrease. Mm-hmm. When you decrease so that Christ can increase, now you're in ministry. Now you're in ministry. Anybody need prayer this morning? Would you stand with me, saints? Okay. Oh, your soul on that praying thing. Man, it's time to pray. Okay. Took you a minute to get there.
Our name's pretty sensitive.
All right. For salvation.
Salvation?
Yeah. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, you see my brother's family? You see these that need salvation. They need to repent, Father, return unto you and glorify your name, and they need healing in their bodies. So, Father, as you send your saving word, and Father, your healing word to them.
Yes.
And Father, send someone that will witness it to them, and they will be receptive because it's anointed of you. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Woo, get ready for that. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's thank the Lord. Hallelujah. Woo. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your love, your goodness, your grace, and your favor. And Father, I thank you for healing, restoring, and blessing,
yes,
and answering prayer. Father, I thank you that not only do you love us, but you sent the most precious thing of all of eternity, your Son, to die for us.
Amen.
And we get your blessings from it.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Father, for his sacrifice,
yes,
and our restoration. Thank you for your love and our reception, that you might be exalted. Go with us, keep us, and bless us, I ask. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Next week, bring at least three friends. Let's fill the house for the Lord. Amen.
Amen.